Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Meeting will come to order, and I'm going to ask Mr. Lashley if he will give our invocation, please.
Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pause at this time to give thanks to you for all that you do in our lives. We just praise you and lift your name up above all names. We ask for your guidance in everything we say and do. And as we set to do the people's business, be with us and lead us in the way you would have us to go. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Okay, in public comments, I'll start with Beverly Kerr. And remember, this is 3 minutes.
3 minutes. Thank you. Our planning board has been reviewing the existing polluting industries ordinance because of the economy. This is an artificial reason created by the people who make money from pollution, people that will probably never experience the consequences of these poor financial decisions, because you can be sure dirty industry will not be located near their homes and businesses. The ordinance is not consistent with the adopted Alamance County Land Development Plan. It does not balance economic development with environmental protection. It does not reflect community values or encourage quality development for the county. It is not in the public interest, especially in light of information presented in the public hearings, as proven by the materials presented. In fact, the only people who weren't against these changes were there to expand junkyards and defend hot-dip galvanizing plants. All other local citizens spoke up for sustainable development and protection of the environment and for attracting clean industry to Alamance County. One of the recommended revisions is to reduce the spacing requirement between polluting industry and homes from 2,000 feet to 250 feet or more. These changes are clearly not for the benefit of the citizens who want safe and clean neighborhoods. The ordinance was adopted in 2006 to promote the health, safety, and general welfare of local citizens and to promote the peace and dignity of the county. As the ordinance reads, these polluting industries produce objectionable levels of noise, odors, vibrations, fumes, light, smoke, and other impacts upon the lands adjacent to them. Toxic and hazardous emissions sometimes contaminate the air and water and soil surrounding the area. So the standards were set to allow for the placement and growth of such uses while still maintaining the health, safety, and general welfare standard of established residential and clean commercial business in Alamance County. My family can speak personally about the burden residential property owners will face when dirty industry is allowed to open in a neighborhood. Their tax value drops, along with the air and water quality and the peace of their neighborhood. How will families feel when they can't plant a vegetable garden because their soil is contaminated from a junkyard or landfill or a galvanizing plant? When they can't sleep at night because of heavy traffic tearing up their roads? When their trees are dying and streams are polluted? Citizens do not want dirty industry in their neighborhood. Neither do schools, medical facilities, churches, or child care centers. The intended purpose of the current ordinance is not to recruit polluting industries. It is to protect others from the pollution of dirty industry. If this revision is approved, just like the newly proposed name says, this ordinance will be transformed into a heavy industrial development ordinance. The new purpose will be to develop polluting industries.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Next is Margaret Namron.
First of all, I think Eddie ought to put his beard back on. I didn't recognize him.
He looks younger.
Do what?
He looks younger.
Oh, yeah. You may not like me after say what I'm going to say.
Oh, we'll still like you, Margaret.
You think so?
Go ahead.
I do not think by no means we should move the county commissioners' meeting place. Because one time before you had it up there, You could hear people speaking, but they were down and you couldn't see nobody. You didn't know who was speaking. So I think we need to leave it like it is, even if we have to modify something. So that's my opinion, and I appreciate if you listen to it. I got a little congestion.
Thank you. Thank you, Margaret. Mm-hmm. Okay, next it's Peter Childers.
Hey, good evening.
Good evening.
I try real hard to keep this down to 3 minutes. It's a page and a half, so
please
bear with me if you'll listen fast.
Read fast.
Here it is. On the agenda tonight is a request to set a public hearing to have the present high-impact polluting industry ordinance replaced. I am speaking to request you not lock in your opinion to accept a change until you've heard presentations tonight and at the public hearing. The memorandum of August 15th by Planning Board Chair and Co-Chair Ken Walker and Bill Griffith states the main reason behind the need for a new ordinance is jobs. In short, the old ordinance hindered job growth. There is no proof the present ordinance has hindered job creation unless you consider the original reason the ordinance was created, which was to lock out an asphalt plant from locating next to one particular residential community. However, asphalt plants are still listed in the proposed ordinance, maintaining their 2,000-foot spacing. Given the Planning Board's stated belief that 2,000-foot spacing hinders job creation, is it the intent of the Planning Board then to pick which jobs it values and which jobs it does not by linking jobs to industry spacing requirements? Is the Planning Board saying they still don't want jobs from listed industries in Class 4 with 2,000-foot spacing, but want those high-value junk car lot jobs in Class 2? If their true belief is for an unfettered, widely diverse industrial sector, surely asphalt plants would be a part of that, not restricted by spacing. Originally, it was stated the ordinance needed to be changed because Payne Oil and Graham was having to move due to an eminent domain issue. It was stated they could not find an adequate new location because of the ordinance. However, Payne Oil is already located to a new site 1 mile from their present location. The memorandum also states the present ordinance prevents expansion or the ability to move existing grandfathered industries. Where is there proof that no suitable locations exist for these industries within the 2,000-foot spacing requirement? It does make locating a new or existing polluting high-impact industry more difficult, but that was and is the intent of the original ordinance, to protect homeowners. As for expansion, that's covered and not restricted by the grandfathering clause in the present ordinance. The memorandum also describes the subcommittee review of the original ordinance as extensive, but I submit it was anything but in relation to the core and most contentious issue, which is spacing. Of the 8 meetings held, only half a meeting, about 2 hours, was devoted to spacing designations, and in the end, the committee chose to use the Rutherford County ordinance proposal. Not one existing industry in any classification had any on-site inspection and review by the subcommittee to evaluate its true impact on the surrounding neighborhood. The proposed spacing designations are simply arbitrary, subjective, and reflect Planning Board member bias against the existing ordinance. They do not represent actual neighborhood impact reality. Another reason used in the introduction for needing a new ordinance is that it did not adequately address the unique nature of Alamance County and was not achieving its intended goal for allowing for the placement and growth of industrial land uses. I ask, just what is the unique nature of Alamance County? Can Planning Board members tell me this? Surely, if it was unique, the Planning Board would not be promoting the adoption of a Rutherford County ordinance. But Alamance is unique in one aspect, from Rutherford County, in that we have a population density larger by 3 times.
Thank you.
Surely that fact would justify longer.
Thank you.
You know, this is not fair to citizens. Three minutes is not fair. It really is not to get any kind of presentation to this body. I mean, you know.
That's the rules.
Well, I would submit that the rules be changed. I mean, this is not fair to have any kind of decent presentation other than just an opinion, a short one-sentence opinion.
I'm sorry. That's all.
I mean, things are, you know, this is not right. Here, I'll submit this anyway. Maybe copies can be made and this can be passed out to commissioners. Is that possible?
Fine. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, that's all of the public hearings. So we will go on now to commissioners' responses. Public comments, commissioners' responses, any?
We're still going to have ours at the end, right?
Yes,
That's what I'm, waiting for.
Okay. Okay. Mr. Matt Williams, you are up next.
Thank you, Commissioners. I'm here tonight to talk about a proposed new industry considering Alamance County and to start the process for the local incentives process for the county. The project is, the company name is, which is part of this particular step as per your new policy, to announce the company name is Ferraro Foods. F-E-R-R-A-R-O, I believe, Ferraro Foods Incorporated. They're based out of Piscataway, New Jersey, and are an Italian, they're an importer and distributor of Italian foods and restaurant products. More information will be provided through the advertisement process as well as at the public hearing itself. And what I would ask for you tonight would be for you to set a date for the public hearing as prescribed by the statutes, to set the date of September 19th for the county's public hearing.
Can I hear a motion?
So moved.
Have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Matt.
Got that one.
Matt, may I ask that, Matt, can you stay to the end of the meeting possibly? Do you have a problem with that? Or if you have somewhere to go, I'd like to talk to him about some figures here.
If I can make a soccer pickup change, I'll be happy to.
We'll be here.
We'll still be here. Okay.
Can you do it now?
I don't want to interrupt the flow of the meeting, however you prefer.
Okay. It's germane to the topic of incentives, but I thought it probably more apropos to have it at the end of the meeting. But
I can stick around and come back.
Okay.
I'd allow Mac to do it while he's here if we're going to have to come back, unless you have to go right now.
No, I don't have to go right this minute. No.
Why don't we give him the benefit, and you're going to have a discussion anyway.
Yeah. If it's okay. It won't take very long. You know, there's been a, and this is just for the sake of discussion and rapping a little bit about the incentive situation and recruiting and so forth. You know, there's always a lot said about what we're not doing, but in my opinion, sometimes there's not enough said about what we are doing or how good we are or how our stats look and so forth. Y'all went down to Gaston County, yes, my understanding. And I supported that we do go out and see what other people are doing. But I do wonder what other people are getting for their money. For instance, Gaston County, it's right near Charlotte. It's right adjacent to Mecklenburg. Is that correct?
Correct.
I believe it is. If you look at Gaston County's median income, according to the stats I got off the census report, I think, there's median income, household median income is $40,940. Ours is $43,103. In other words, we're over $2,000 greater. Their unemployment rate's 12.2. Ours is 11.4. Their tax rate, according to what I saw on this last report that I saw, 83.5 cents. I mean, that is stunning. Ours is 52. Their bond indebtedness is, I think, four times higher than ours. School performance, on the 8 end of grade test, we're beating them 6 out of 8. What are they getting for their money? What are they getting for their recruitment efforts? I mean, if we're beating them in all those categories, I mean, what's happening down there that you think should, or, you know, that money should yield the results? I mean, it's obviously not doing it. I'm just curious. What did y'all see when you went down there that yields maybe some support for these figures here?
The reason for going was just simply to do that, to see what others are doing and how they're doing it. We looked at some comparison or some things that seemed to be reasonable to think that Gaston would be a good county to go to. Many of the things that you just described, we didn't really consider. We just looked at a community that is near a metropolitan area like we are, on an interstate like we are, that had an economy like ours, that has suffered the same challenges that ours has suffered with the textile base. And what was the reaction to it, and what are they doing different? I don't know that we'll ever find any place that's exactly like we are in all the different categories there are to measure. So we started out as a place to go to see what we could find out. For them, I think it was and they will tell you that from an employment standpoint, they actually have not, that the employment thing with all the ups and downs has not, they haven't gotten a lot of employment out of it in the sense of taking a graph that was going this way and going back up that way. But it's not going as bad down that way as it once was without doing anything about it. So they were just trying to do something about that. But more important was the tax base issue, I think, for them, as was told to us. And Craig, you can jump in here and correct me if that's what, because we asked him that question too, what are you getting for it? And he showed us graphs and charts and about employment and about tax base. And he said this was our public policy decision to go at it this way, and it evolved over time. It wasn't I don't think they started out doing what they're doing now. It's been an evolution of what to do. And also, I think part of it is the competitive nature of that particular market. The Charlotte area, people that companies want that want to look in that area also have can be Charlotte centric and also be in South Carolina. And so even the Charlotte partnership has as part of its group four or five counties in South Carolina that the Charlotte regional partnership markets. Because of the Charlotte people, it doesn't matter which, as long as they're Charlotte area, it doesn't matter if it's North or South Carolina. And so that puts an extra competitive burden, I think, on the folks immediately in that market. We don't necessarily suffer that too badly here, but that's, I think, one step for doing a little bit more than they might otherwise have done. So it's just a public policy decision they made in terms of how to approach being competitive for that market. We didn't go down there to come back to say this is what we recommend. We went down to see what, again, we thought our function as staff people for you all as ultimate decision makers is to come back and give you some specific things that others are doing for you to have options and to understand what's out there. And however you decide to react to that is ultimately going to be you all's role. But this is just one thing that a community is doing. There will be others that we will probably go look at. I got a suggestion today on some other places we might could go that are, again, in North Carolina that are often used as comparisons for us on other things, other public policy questions that you all talk about.
Yeah. Well, and I'll be brief here. I'm almost through. There's no pattern there that I see they're getting anything for their money as far as the bang. I mean, we're whipping them in every category, in my opinion. And the John Locke Foundation, I just got this in the mail today. I was apropos to get this today, and I saw it. It's a list of 92 counties. Excuse me, 66 counties that gave incentives between 2004 and 2006. And 92 responded to the out of 100 to the survey that was done by North Carolina Institute for Constitutional Law, and we know how they feel about incentives. And 66 gave money, and on a per capita basis, Gaston was 12th out of 66, and we were 52nd. Their per capita was right at $58 per, and ours is roughly $4 per. So, and it does show all the counties giving money and what it is per capita. And it's interesting to see whether, you know, and I think you have to make an analysis whether you get anything for your money or whether they would come anyway and or, you know, let nature take its course. We do need jobs. I agree with that. But I was really shocked to see that Gaston really doesn't have anything I would trade for, in my opinion. What square miles are they? How many square miles are they?
The area of the county?
Yeah.
That's a good question. I don't know that I know the specific answer. They're probably reasonably close to ours, but yeah. I don't know the answer for specifically.
Their population is a little bit higher, a good bit higher, 50,000, I think.
And they also have a lot of smaller communities all within the same county jurisdiction the way we do as well. So, but that's again, that's their commissioner's public policy decision on how they want to try to be prepared and competitive in an increasingly competitive process.
But you look at Guilford County. Guilford County's median household income 44.4, ours 43.1. I would contend that cost of living and high taxes would eat that gap up. And I mean, you know, numbers can say a lot of things. And I've been accused of twisting them, but I think there's good figures. Those are good figures. Thank you for staying.
Thank you, Matt.
Thank you for allowing me to have the conversation with you and still get soccer pickup done. I appreciate that.
You're a good father.
Okay. Next on our agenda is Sheriff's annual report presentation. Sheriff Johnson.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before I get started, let me give each one of you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. What time is that?
He's chasing that guy.
I'm not taking him back.
If we could, let's get started. You know, this is our annual report. The reason it is now, September is the fact that the crime statistics have come out from the SBI, we get those and we work on our report, annual report, along with some of the finances. And I'd like to thank Chief Deputy Tim Britt who really helped put this thing together and basically ramrodded it. And also Amy Weaver for helping Tim double check our figures, I think, on some things. And what I'd like to do right now is just get started. Okay, this is just basically a message that I'm not going to get into. It's in the booklet from me, our mission statement. Here's what I'm very proud of, I think. In some ways, we're looking to do better. If you would, turn over to the budget and finance. First of all, let me say, and we're dealing with the fiscal year 2010 to 2011. The sheriff's budget for the enforcement side was $9,405,257.70. Our school resource officer budget was $392,073. Our jail budget was $8,911,398.31 for a total budget for the entire sheriff's operations of $18,708,729.01. Okay, what you see next is the revenue. The sheriff's side brought in, this is the enforcement side, $534,401.02. This is off of things like our carrying concealed weapon permits, our civil papers, regular gun permits, etc. On the SRO side, the grant is received by the school system, and they have given us $304,675. Our jail. Come in, this is bed rental space, phone service, everything. It brought in $4,667,429.08 in revenue. Okay, as you see the total here, we had a total budget, like I said, of $18,708,729.01 and $5,506,505.10 in revenue. Okay, the sheriff's office only spent that year in the budget $17,337,907.40. If you will take the revenue that come in along with what we turn back over at the end of the year, our total operating expenses was $11,831,402.30 with the revenue and what we turn back in. And, of course, I assure you I've caught a lot of heat over the years, but we're trying to put it out here the way it really is. If you will look now on the 2009-2010 budget, you'll see basically the same thing. The only difference was our jail brought in more. And as Mr. Sutton said, our population is down, and we're trying to work now to try to get it back up with our federal people. But if you'll look at the budget reduction in 2010, 2011, our budget was reduced $1,025,231.85. The balance returned to the county at the end of the year that we did not spend because we tried to, if we didn't have to fill spots, if we wouldn't push a lot of lap salary build up and a lot of other things, was $1,370,822. And like I say, our total cost for running the entire sheriff's operations was $11,831,402.30. Okay, in 11 and 12 budget, we reduced our budget another $428,916. So we don't know what it's going to be at the end of this term, into the this year, because we're probably going to have more inmates coming in. So I wanted to point that out to you, commissioners, what's actually going on in the revenue. Moving on. Like I said, in 2010, the mandatory in-service training, this is involving our personnel. For the Sheriff's Office accounted for 6,744 hours of training. In addition to mandated yearly training, employees completed 9,210 hours of advanced or specialized training. With law enforcement today, we have to have our people trained because things are changing so dramatically. Sheriff's Office reflects the second lowest, talk about personnel now, second lowest sworn to population ratio in the county. Local agencies also have a lower ratio than national and state averages. The national average, they say, should be 2.5 sworn officers per 1,000 population. Currently, we have 2.1, and we're the second lowest. Only anybody else any lower than us would be Mebane at 2.0. And I understand they just recently getting ready to get, I think, 6 new officers through grants, so they're going to will be last. And I'm very proud with just that number per 1,000 population. Our people are doing the job they're doing. Just wanted to point that out to the commissioners. Okay, let's go further. Activity statistics. In this past year, we calls for service, 37,635 calls for service. Investigations, if folks want to investigate, we work murders, raids, robberies. You just don't do them overnight. It ain't like CSI on TV. There's a lot more work than that. But 5,606 investigation, 2,172 security checks. If anybody goes off on vacation, wants the sheriff's office to check their residence, all they have to do to call, we put it in a CCOM computer, and it pops up, and our officers check it. Citations, 1,679. Arrests, 2,892. Warrants received, 4,961, and we have to serve those warrants. Warrants served, 3,774. And let me tell you something. Most people got warrants on them, don't want to be found. So it ain't just you go pick them up and go. You have to chase them. Same thing with the civil processes. We received 13,692. We were able to serve 10,426. Some of those were returned because the lawyer called and said, hey, it's been taken care of. How about sending it back, etc. Gun permits, 2,561. Carrying concealed weapons, 632. Property stolen from Alamance County, $1,483,436.25. Property recovered, $215,358.75. And we'll continue to recover that property as we make arrests in cases. The animal control. Lord, I wish the animal control belonged to the health department again. People get more upset around them than they do double homicides. Calls for service, 2,500. Don't ask me how it come out even, but it was double checked because that was my first question. Follow-up investigation, 2,081. Animals transported to the shelter, and that's a shame. 2,625 homeless animals or animals taken to that shelter, which is a shame. All right, crime rates. This is 2009 versus 2010. Murder. In 2009, we had 3. We cleared 2. We have suspects in the other one. We're just having to continue to work. 2010, we had 5 murders, 4 cleared, and we have suspects in the 2010 murders. Just a matter of working and trying to get the case together. Rapes, we had 8 in 2009, cleared 8. We had 5 in 2010, cleared 5. Robbery, we had 15, cleared 9. In 2009,
12 and 7, and I'll just let you look at the rest of it. As you can see, our clearance rate.
Sheriff, are the ones cleared from the same year necessarily or not?
No, sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's not. But I can tell you, we have two that has happened that we are currently working. We have suspects, just a matter of getting everything together, believe me. And most of those were gang related.
Just they had a gang problem.
Yeah. Okay, let's move on. All right, here's something I'm very proud of, folks.
And I'm telling you, I'm very proud of our people. Out of the 25 top agencies with similar population size, Alamance County has the fifth lowest crime rate of the 25. You see, Burlington has the highest, and I'm not slapping Burlington. They have a more condensed population, so that may count for that.
But I'm very proud of that, and I won't be happy, and my agents, my officers say, I'm never satisfied until we get right there at number one, Orange County.
Yes. But we are ranked out of 383 law enforcement agencies that submit statistics to the FBI and to the SBI. We are 61st in best crime rate out of 383 agencies that report. And that I still don't not satisfied that's good enough, but it's a heck of a lot better than the rest of them on it. Okay, let's go to our clearance rates now. And this is another one I'm proud of. Murder. The United States average is 67%. North Carolina average is 85%. Sheriff's Office is 80. We're a little bit below the North Carolina standards. If we can clear those the homicides instead, we would be 100%. And like I say, we have suspects and we're constantly working. Rate. United States average 41%. North Carolina 60. We had 100% clearance rate. Robbery. 28% United States. North Carolina 40. We had 58%. Aggravated assault, 19%. The United States, 67%. North Carolina, we had 75%. With an overall average of our crimes, 75%. Now, your Uniform Crime Index deals with, per 100 percentage of per 100,000 population that we'll get to in just a minute. If you will look, the clearance rate on burglaries, we're above average, North Carolina and national. A little bit below average in North Carolina, but above national on larceny. Above average on motor vehicle theft, with an overall clearance rate of 25%. And I'm very proud of that. We, like I said, if it wasn't for the murder, I'd like to have 100% there, and eventually I think we'll get the other two. This is just showing you Alamance County Sheriff's Office and a graph compared to North Carolina and the United States and your murder. See, we're a little bit low in North Carolina, but way above in rape, we're way above in robbery, way above in aggravated assaults, we're way above in overall. Then we go to burglary, we're above state and national. Larceny, we're a little bit below North Carolina, but above national. Motor vehicle theft, way above on the solution, and the overall, just a little bit under. So, Sheriff's Office exceeded national clearance rate in all the index crimes. Okay, let's go to detention.
Alamance County detention generated, it's 2010, it says $5,506,505 attendant revenue for the 2010 fiscal year. From July 2006 to December 2010, the detention center has generated $22,337,273.74 in revenue that went into the general fund. That didn't come back to me. That went into the general fund. Revenue is primarily generated through the leasing of unused bed space to federal authority.
I mean, right there, and some of the commissioners ought to be commended for their views on the detention center here in Alamance County, because it has helped tremendously, I think, our county financing in a lot of ways.
However, this figure does include local and state inmate reimbursement, transport fees, court jail fees, social security reimbursement, scout, inmate medical charges, and commissary phone and commission. More inmates you have in jail, more phones they use, more money comes in. Same thing, the commissary, you know, they want candy, stuff like that, they can buy it. All revenue generated by detention center is directed to Alamance County's general fund as required by North Carolina law. Okay, down here, you've got inmate admission activity, federal 861, ICE 3,288, pretrial 8,015, sentence 2,245, and writs, that means we bring them back for trial, 238, for a total inmate admission activity of 14,000. 647 inmates that's been in that jail fiscal year. Also, we have our transportation. What a lot of people don't understand, we have to transport every prisoner to the prison system, or if they've got other charges in other counties, if they don't come get them, we transport them. And with that, that's transporting events, 834, the number of inmates, and we try to transport two or three at a time, you know, if you go to a prison somewhere. Inmates transport was 2,072. Medical transport events, we have to transport them to the hospital, back and forth to doctors, 205. Inmates medically transported, 210, for a transport mileage of 125,284 miles of transporting inmates. And that's dollar, yes, sir.
Can you speculate, seat of the britches there, on that $22 million, what it would have been had we not had ICE and federal? It'd been under $1 million probably, wouldn't it? Or would it have been a little bit over there?
We've been as far as the money coming
in. Yeah, revenue.
Oh, yes. Yes, sir. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. It was a genius idea.
It wasn't either. It's just common sense. But if you compare us to some other jails that aren't doing it, their revenue stream is definitely...
Listen, everybody now is jumping on the bandwagon wanting ICE inmates or U.S. Marshal inmates because of basically what we've done down here. What we've done down here.
All right, moving on. Let's talk a little about our different...
this is our ICE activity. Boy, is that a sore subject with me. detainees interviewed. Now, they say we're profiling them. I'm going to tell you something, folks. We're doing a bad, bad job of profiling if we only brought in 402 inmates in a year. We're doing a bad job of profiling. Interviewed 402, aliens processed. Of those 402, 307 were here illegally. We're here illegally. And the others were released after the interview process was conducted. There was 307 detainers lodged. That means that you know, you can't go until the federal government allows you to go. 203s lodged at where they go. They have to go to state court. We've arrested them. They have to go to state court. As soon as their charges is disposed of in state court, they roll over automatically into ICE, and that's when we start getting paid per day per bed on that. Now, they say that, you know, we didn't have, all we're doing is messing with DWIs and all that here. Now, that's wrong, or no license. Aggravated felons. This means that they have had a prior criminal history or have been previously deported with a criminal history and returned back into the United States in Alamance County, Harris 2. Notice to appear. They say, you know, we treat these people bad. Well, a lot of these inmates that come in, after detainers are filed, they say, okay, these are your stipulations. You follow them. Here's a notice to appear in Charlotte, Mecklenburg County Federal Court for deportations proceedings if the judge so sees fit. There was 245 that was done with. 862 notice and stipulations, certain stipulations, we had none. Reentry, 27 that was picked up here on other charges had reentered the United States after previously being deported for a criminal offense or just previously been deported. Fugitives, 8 that was wanted somewhere else for some other serious crime in Alamance County. Involuntary work program, 1, that means they overstayed their visa. Voluntary removal, 24, you pick them up, they say, look, if you'll let me go, I'll go back to my home country. You don't have to do anything. They take them to the border, let them go. Okay. Aliens with prior immigration arrest or criminal arrest record, 137 of the 307. Folks, I'm going to continue to do what we're doing here in Alamance County because my job is to protect the people and commissioners. That's what we're going to do. Aliens previously processed by Alamance County. We had 11 that was processed, deported, returned. I bet they don't come back. Total number of inmates processed that had federal and out-of-state warrants, 4. Classification offense, there was 404 misdemeanor charges. Felonies, 119. That's 119 felons that would have been left on our streets had we not encountered them, with a total of 523 charges. Now you say, well, how can you have 523 charges with 307 processed? Well, some of them may have a rape robbery. Some of them may have a hit-and-run DWI. Etc. Okay, In 2010, the Sheriff's Office, in cooperation with local, state, and federal authorities, seized $2,727,153.27 in currencies, vehicles, and property pursuant to drug investigations. That's where we've been, you know, we've had to pick up and buy cars and stuff because the economy's been so bad. $343,173.46 was awarded to the Sheriff's Office by virtue of asset forfeiture laws. These monies were used to purchase equipment to offset costs to the taxpayers. And I can't tell you much, but it was just a short period ago, and it ain't been publicized, and I saw them on study at $1.69 million seized right here in Burlington. So hopefully we're going to come out all right on that. Gangs. There are over 500 validated gang members present in Alamance County, and they say that for every one gang member, there's usually 10 more that are unknown to law enforcement. And believe me, here in Alamance County, we believe that's the case. We have an educator here. She can tell you in the schools. That's all I'm going to say right there. And let me tell you something. This picture was taken in one of our high schools. That was taken in one of our middle schools. This was taken in another one. Now let me show you here. You see, everybody's got dark colors on except the guy in the middle. That is a message being sent by the Crips to the Bloods. The Bloods wear red, Crips wear red. Being sent to them, hey, we got you surrounded. That's where your gang fights start with stuff like that. Put that local middle school. I won't tell you which one, but we're right close to it. That's all I'm saying. And the sad thing is a lot of our teachers and our principals don't know what to look for, and that's why we're trying to do education. Domestic violence. 2010, across the state, domestic violence displaced 13,380 persons who stayed in domestic violence shelter. 6,047 of them were children, kids. Domestic violence-related murders in North Carolina totaled 73. I know since I've been sheriff, probably more than half, I know a whole lot more than half of the murders we've had here has been domestic violence-related. Sheriff's Office responded to 571 reports of domestic violence and served 611 protection orders in 2010. Since 2003, the Sheriff's Office has maintained a full-time domestic violence unit to investigate all reports of domestic violence. And there's a lot of times domestic violence reported it's not, but we make sure that it's not through investigation. Sheriff's Office participated in a collaboration to found the Family Justice Center, the first in the state of North Carolina, which works with domestic violence victims and family problems. Okay, school resource officer, and that's going to be right along the school system. Folks, I'm going to tell you something. We got a problem in this county right now, drugs in our schools, period. I'm telling you, every school here, and gangs. Sheriff's Office maintains school resource officers in middle and high schools in the county. These schools include Southern High, Southern Middle, Western High, Western Middle, Eastern High, Woodlawn Middle. We had 1,379 calls for service during this year. Felony arrests was 16. Felony drug arrests were 10. Misdemeanor arrests 166. Misdemeanor drug arrests 71. And weapons confiscated 12 in our public schools. And you know what? We are probably only getting 2 to 3% of what's on them school records. That's scary. And we expect our teachers to teach when really they can't because of what's going on. Dare, we have Dare and all the Clover Garden, Pleasant Grove, B. Everett Jordan, Alexander Wilson, M. Holt, Sylvan, and AO Elementary School. This is a program that I think is a very important program, drug abuse resistant education. It teaches our kids a lot about life as they grow older. Internet crimes against children. I think it's one of the best things that we've done, Commissioner, lately, and that we got in part of a grant with Guilford County. We created Internet Crimes Against Children. The ICAT unit, Internet Crimes Against Children, made 32 arrests. Now, these are sick individuals all over the United States. If we can make them on the coast, we go get them. If it's down on the coast, we go get them. 32 arrests, filed 364 charges, conducted 57 search warrants, executed 49 court orders, and made 30 forensic examinations. We have people trained that can go into computers, take the hard drives, get whatever information we off of it. We find a lot of child sexual predators. If we get us a computer, get their hard drive, and they're transmitting pictures of kids and stuff in sexual situations, they can be charged with every picture that's on that thing. Sheriff Office has been a member of state and federal Internet Crimes Against Children Task Force since 2009. There are two ICAT investigators with the Sheriff's Office. who take both proactive and reactive measures to online predators, sex offenders, and child pornography. We have computers down there. They're posing, and I'll just tell you, they're posing as kids all the time, young females and stuff. You'll be surprised on how many people hit on them. And then when that conversation strikes up, hey, well, you made a, you know, meet me for sex, here's a picture of me, send me a picture of you, blah, 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 and all that stuff. And they wind up meeting, and when they meet, they get arrested and by officers. Okay, that's the end of the presentation. This is just our canine unit, which we expanded since I've been sheriff. We actually have five dogs, canines. One is in the jail.
Any questions?
Is he locked up,
right?
Do
what?
Is he locked up?
Look, hey, he's straightening them out in there when they get out of hand, right, I will tell you that.
Any questions for the sheriff?
Please.
No, thank you. Did a great job. It's a good report.
Thank you.
Just give him a hand.
Well, hey, we couldn't do it without y'all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
We appreciate what you do, Cheryl.
Yeah. Moving right along. Budget amendments, Mr. Bass. That's a good report.
Thank you, ma'am, gentlemen. Mm-hmm. Two simple budget amendments for tonight. The first one, a budget member number number 26, is for $1,000, and this one is from the Food and Drug Administration, a voluntary National Food Regulatory Program. And what we're doing there is trying to implement the National Food Code in Alamance County, which is going to be as a national code that the state of North Carolina is looking to for national standard. And because our environmental health section has been doing so well and implementing those rules, they've been awarded $1,000, and these funds will be used towards computer equipment and to software licenses for our folks who are in the field doing food and lodging inspections, so they can do the inspections while they're out in the field. Okay. So that's what we're asking for y'all to approve for that.
I hear a motion to approve.
So moved.
Have a motion.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. No opposed.
Thank you all.
Okay.
And the second one is for $1,400 for an asthma grant. You all may remember I've been up here before with our asthma grant, which is really a good project. We work a lot with the schools on this for asthma education. Part of it, you've seen the colored flags that fly around. We've also used it like for magnets on the sides of vehicles and such. You may have seen them on ACTA, and we have them like our environmental health vehicles. So this will, and also we're going to be doing like buying the anti-idling signs at the schools, as well as buying some more flags with this. So that's what the $1,410 is for budget amendment 27.
So moved.
Have a motion. Thanks. And a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. I appreciate it.
You have a flu shot, champ, man?
Yes, ma'am. And we'll be announcing that shortly for setting up our flu clinics.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Next is Jason Martin with the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance and to set a public hearing for this.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. You should have in your packets a memorandum from me regarding the proposed heavy industrial development ordinance, along with a copy of the draft ordinance. And I'll be as brief as I can tonight, because I know we still have a busy agenda. Basically, in early 2011, the Planning Board decided to look at the existing high-impact land uses, including industries ordinance. And from that, actually created a subcommittee of their members, which consisted of Bill Griffith, our vice chair, Ray Cobb, Todd Lambert, and Thomas Jones. They met 8 times in the spring through from March to May. At that point, there was a lot of discussion about adding flexibility to the ordinance. And I should state that initially, the Planning Board was interested in adding flexibility to the existing ordinance, to look at amendments and ways to do that. And we looked at several different things. The discussions took place about conditional use permitting, about special use permitting. And after consultation with our legal department, with the assistant county attorney, it was determined that those were not really valid options for this ordinance. Those are more functions of other land use planning, such as zoning and things like that. So at that point, the Planning Board began to look at ways to add flexibility to the ordinance, and specifically with regards to the spacing requirements. So the Planning Board subcommittee did meet 8 times between March and May, and there came a point where looking at doing an amendment to the ordinance was so extensive that the subcommittee wanted to go back to the planning board and request to do a complete rewrite of the ordinance, which is what came out of these meetings, was the heavy industrial development ordinance. Just in general, to talk about the differences between the two ordinances, because there are some differences. The minimum lot size, those requirements remain the same between the two ordinances, 10 acres for everything except for racetracks. That is a requirement of 40 acres. Building heights remain the same for 40 feet. Both have protected facilities, both ordinances kept the same list of protected facilities. The big difference was the spacing requirements and the inclusion of a classification system, a tiered system, which is what I believe Mr. Childers had referred to earlier. The planning board did put in this ordinance four different classifications that range between 250 feet in spacing to 2,000 feet, being the most restrictive. And those went from 250 feet, 500 feet, 1,000 feet, and 2,000 feet. And of course, under the existing ordinance, everything was flat 2,000 feet. Both ordinances do have stream buffers. The existing ordinance provides a 100-foot stream buffer off of perennial streams. The proposed ordinance will buffer perennial and intermittent streams. Both ordinances have a screening requirement. The existing ordinance is 100 feet. The proposed ordinance varies between 30 and 60 feet depending on the classification system. And I'll explain a little bit more detail about the screening here in a minute. Another big change between the two ordinances was the inclusion of an operation setback. If you think of it in terms of like building setbacks, you may be able to build your building within 10 feet of a side property line. This would put a further distance from the property line to put a little bit of separation from an adjacent property line, as opposed to the facility itself, to the protected facility, a house, but from the property line inward as well. And so that's an operational setback that includes the entire area of operations. And one thing I handed out to you all tonight that I did not include in the packet, and I apologize, is a drawing that Todd Lambert on the planning board did that I think was very helpful to the planning board that gives you an idea of what a site plan may look like under this ordinance. And Todd is here this evening, as is Phil Griffith and Ken Walker from the planning board. And Todd is an engineer with Simmons Engineering and Surveying, and he was kind enough to draw that for the planning board. The existing ordinance does have a gating and fencing requirement. The proposed ordinance does not. And the purpose behind that, based on the planning board's decision, was that these industries are likely to go ahead and fence and gate these sites anyway, just to protect their own investment. They did not feel that there needs to be a requirement in the ordinance for that. The new ordinance, or the proposed ordinance, does also provide for some lighting guidelines. It's not an exact requirement, but it does suggest that lighting be done in such a manner that shields the lighting from adjacent properties, which there's really no reference to that in the existing ordinance. Another major change between the two ordinances is the proposed ordinance does require permit renewals. So as a permit is issued every 3 years, the permit would need to be renewed. And the purpose behind that is to make sure that the industry is maintaining their screening buffers and that they're following the site plan that they submitted. Under the existing ordinance, once the permit's issued, it's issued. And there's really no follow-up on that. And the three-year time frame, initially this was discussion about this being an annual review process, a renewal process. 3 years is more in line with what other permits are for renewals. A lot of air quality permits are 3 years, and other state permitting as well, is to provide a little continuity in that. Both ordinances do have spacing waiver procedures to where if they cannot meet the land use spacing, they can request a waiver of that. And it's a little unique. Under the existing ordinance, it is done through an easement, and the industry would have to request an easement from each property owner within that 2,000 feet to be able to get a waiver of the spacing requirement. Under the proposed ordinance, the industry would actually grant an easement to the property owner, to the protective facility. And at that point, that opens up the ability for the protective facility to negotiate with the industry to say, I'll waive this if you plant more trees or something like that. And it gives the property owner a little more flexibility and latitude to be able to enforce that through court proceedings as well. A major difference between
Would you handle that for them if they negotiating with the neighbor?
We've never had that happen before under the existing ordinance. We've never had anybody actually come forward to do an easement at that time.
Well, the cities do that a lot.
Yeah.
The cities do that.
I would think we would need to coordinate with the legal department on that. The existing ordinance does not have any variance procedures, which is very different. In the proposed ordinance, there is a procedure in there for applying for a variance if something is unique to the property that they just cannot meet because the topography is a certain way or something like that. The civil penalties under the proposed ordinance are $500 per day per violation. Under the existing ordinance, it's capped at $50. The existing ordinance also treats violations as a criminal offense. The proposed ordinance decriminalizes that and focuses more on civil penalties. One thing that I think is very unique between the two ordinances is the existing ordinance does not do any kind of mapping of industries. If you receive a permit, a business receives a permit, there's no mapping of that industry. Under the proposed ordinance, this would be mapped and actually be a layer in GIS to where you can turn that on and it would show the spacing requirement based on the classification for that industry around it. And it would be mapped in GIS, so if somebody's doing title search work or research on, you know, surrounding properties with real estate agents or anything like that, this would allow a little more transparency and a little more disclosure as well. The existing ordinance does not allow for the transfer of permits. If an industry is issued a permit and they sell their interest in their industry to another party, that permit becomes null and void. Under the proposed ordinance, this would be allowed. The industries could sell their interest, you know, between parties. Both do have grandfathering clauses. That is a little bit different in the proposed ordinance. Under the existing ordinance, industries that are grandfathered are allowed to expand to any property. They're allowed to expand within their own boundaries and to adjacent properties as long as they owned or leased the property prior to the adoption of the ordinance. The existing ordinance or the proposed ordinance would allow expansion on the property, but only within the boundaries of the existing property, not to any adjacent property. And then also one other unique characteristic here is the Tier 2 reporting, which for those of you that are not familiar with Tier 2 reporting, that is reporting that's done with the Fire Marshal's Office for any chemicals that are stored at a business. And as part of the renewal process, this would become something that they would need to provide proof that they've been following through with that and paying the fees to the Fire Marshal's Office as required. And the purpose behind that is purely for public safety. You know, first responders need to know what kind of chemicals are being housed at that industry. If there's a fire, then they know how to treat it, and it avoids any kind of injury that could be easily avoidable. Now, the number of industries does appear that there are more industries in the proposed ordinance versus the existing ordinance. This is a little misleading. The proposed ordinance is really a delineation of industries. For example, the existing ordinance regulates landfills. The proposed ordinance would separate that out from inert debris landfills versus sanitary landfills. One would have a greater spacing requirement than the other. Automobile salvage yards would not have as far of a spacing requirement as, for example, a metal recycling facility, something what they refer to as the metal mountain in the meetings. Also, another good example of that would be for electricity generating facilities. If they use fossil fuels, that would have a further spacing requirement than if it was, green or renewable energy. And I do have, again, just the ordinance you should have in your packets as well. I'll be glad to take any questions you all have at this time. As well, I ask if Chairman Walker or Vice Chairman Griffith have any comments they'd like to add, as well as Planning Board Member Todd Lambert. So.
The reference to Rutherford County, what's that about?
When the Planning Board first started looking at this ordinance, one of the first things they asked me to do was to pull all of the ordinances that other counties had done, such as Allegheny County, I believe it was Ashe County.
Watauga?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there were several of them, about eight or nine, I believe. And Rutherford was one that used a tiered system, and there was another county that used a tiered system, and that was something that the Planning Board liked. They kind of looked at those more closely than the other ordinances.
Did all the county examples, were they county, did they have countywide zoning, or did some, none of them had countywide zoning?
No, not any of them.
Which made them comparable to what we were looking at.
I think Watauga County at one time had an ordinance similar to this, but they have countywide zoning, I believe, now.
Now, the prior ordinance was based on Rockingham to a great degree, wasn't it?
The closest that I can tell is Allegheny. It looks very similar to, the original ordinance looks very similar to Allegheny County.
Okay.
Not Rockingham.
Rockingham's got countywide zoning.
Yeah, they are definitely zoned.
Any more questions?
Well, I know this is very controversial to a lot of people, but I respect the heck out of Bill Griffith from knowing him in the banking industry, and the other gentleman here I have a lot of respect for. I have to hope that all this has gone through the SIFs, the governmental SIFs. Has any outside source reviewed this?
No, outside of the staff, no. I haven't sent this out to any of my counterparts in another county or anything like that. Really, it's been reviewed by the Planning Board, the subcommittee, and then staff level with Ben and myself and Jessica, and at the very end, Craig also reviewed it as well. So, but there was a great deal of time and effort put in to the meetings. I will say that.
They had the subcommittee. How many meetings was it you guys had?
There were.
So there was a lot of discussion that was put into this thought process of putting this thing together, and there was public comment offered at that also, right, Mr. Childers?
I'm sorry, my 3 minutes are up.
All you got to say is yes or no. You did make comment, though, right?
Yeah. Okay.
The subcommittee meetings typically lasted right at about 4 hours, I believe. Almost every one of them were 4 hours long. We had eight meetings. The last one was probably the shortest one. The meeting was after the last meeting when they made a recommendation to the Planning Board. That meeting was recessed until the Planning Board meeting. At that time, Vice Chairman Griffin reconvened the meeting. They adopted the minutes at that point, and then the Planning Board took it over. So technically, meetings were never canceled. It was recessed until that point.
Yeah. You also made, I know of at least one presentation to the community.
Yes, sir, I apologize.
You had the opportunity to get feedback.
Yes.
Which would have been external to your.
Yeah, that is correct. I was asked to speak at the Commercial Realtors Luncheon and did speak about this ordinance at that meeting. And I got a lot of feedback at that meeting as well. Most of it seemed to be fairly positive from what I could gather. So.
Okay. So we need to set a public hearing for this?
What staff would like to recommend is that we put this out a month, because that way, if there's additional information that the board needed between now and the public hearing, or if we needed to set a special call workshop for you to go a lot more in detail on the ordinance and a lot longer presentation and a lot more workshop type discussion, please let us know. We can set that up fairly quickly and fairly easily.
Okay.
But we wanted to give you that option. When is our meeting
in October? What are our meeting dates?
October 9th?
3rd,
excuse me. 3rd and 17th in October.
Would one work better as far as what you know of coming up? Or?
Well, we originally projected to say October 3rd would be the public hearing date. So that would give us a month between now and October 3rd to have any type workshop between them.
I'd like to entertain make a motion that we go ahead and set it then for the October 3rd date.
Second.
I have a motion and a second for October 3rd for the public hearing. Is that right, Mr. Honeycutt?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Yep.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed?
I mean...
You in favor? Okay. Okay, so we're going to have the public hearing on October the 3rd.
Hey, Madam Chair, if I can say a really strong public thanks to Jason and Jessica and the planning board for all the work that they've done on this. They really have done a yeoman's work in setting up the subcommittee and the amount of public input that they have tried to receive through the process and making it as open as possible. And I do appreciate the work that Jason's done on this.
Okay.
Thank you.
And
thank you. And you're up again.
That's when I hope is a little less controversial. So this is to get money. if I can find my notes here.
You need mine?
No, got it right here.
Okay.
Yeah, you should have a memo in your packet. Again, this is regarding the ROPE public hearing, and ROPE is the Rural Operating Assistance Program. This is a grant that the county applies for every year to provide services through transportation services for elderly and disabled citizens, as well as Work First transportation. At this time, the county is scheduled to be awarded $286,712 in ROPE funding for fiscal year 2011-2012. The elderly and disabled transportation assistance portion of this funding is $104,682. The EMPL and Work First funding, which is used for, again, transportation for those to job training to their jobs, as well as to do car repairs and things like that, $64,681. And then rural general public, which is kind of a catch-all for transportation, $117,349. Staff recommends setting a public hearing for Monday, September 19th. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions you all have.
So moved.
Any questions at this time? If not, I have a motion already on the floor. And a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Likewise. Got it.
Thank you.
Next is our facilities improvement plan additional projects. Mr. Tim Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. Yeah, before your request, after nearly 3.5 years of work, we're finally almost nearing completion of numerous renovation and repair projects which comprise a facility improvement plan. Once the finances are reconciled, we anticipate that we'll have approximately $650,000 remaining. Although we were able to do a whole lot of work under the facility improvement plan, there's still some projects that need to be done in the county. And so what we're coming to the board now is asking that you allow us to move forward with five different projects. The first one is the Youth Services Building. The next one is the Family Justice Center, Environmental Services, Civil Courts Building, and Criminal Courts Building. And I do have an explanation out beside each one. Those basically the type of renovation and repair work we're looking at doing. I do want to point out with the first one, the Youth Services Building, of course, is the building across the street. We're going to be relocating judicial services into that building once the clerk's office vacates that and moves back to the historic courthouse. Currently, we're paying, $26,400 a year in rent. that once we're able to relocate them over there, we will no longer have those lease payments. So we'll be able to save that much money each year on rent. And then also the second thing about the Youth Services Building is one of the nonprofits that is using that facility, they anticipate they'll be able to contribute $25,000 towards those repairs. So we will have those two issues dealing with the Youth Services Building. And then one correction on Family Justice, it was actually soffit work. No, I think the fascia boards have already been wrapped, so the rest of it needs to be addressed. So these are the cost estimates for it, totaling $280,000. We do hope that we will come under those budgeted amounts, but those are the budgets that we have set for each of those projects. That's the first items that we would like to address. Of course, again, we have anticipate having about approximately $650,000. The second two items that are, or second set items that are down at the bottom, is the there were two projects that the board previously authorized that we do work at. One was Eli Whitney, where we repaired the roof and the court, put in a new heating system, and also in the process of putting a new handicap ramp at that facility. The board had authorized an expenditure out of our fund balance of $100,000. All of those repairs down there are total around $87,000. The second project was the Pleasant Grove. To recall, we had a fire there. We removed two of the buildings that were located there, replaced those with a modular facility, and then we've renovated the gym. We did get some insurance proceeds to do that project. What was outside of the insurance proceeds, the board did authorize expenditure of $200,000 to come out of fund balance. The total for those repairs outside of the insurance proceeds was about $197,000. So we have $284,000 there. What we would like to do is, once we kind of have reconciled all the finances, did the five projects that we were requesting to do, is that we would be able to, instead of using that money out of fund balances, use proceeds from the facility improvement plan to reimburse the county for those two projects. So, and then when all those projects are done, if we have some money still remaining, we'll come back to the board at that time and address the issue of how the board would like that money to be spent.
Okay. Any questions of Mr. Burgess? I want to say the people at Pleasant Grove are thrilled to have that modular.
Very nice.
How about the other side of the county, Eli Whitney? Are they thrilled too?
Yeah, they're happy too.
Okay. I hadn't heard that they were not. So. Okay.
Yeah, I've heard it from Pleasant Grove people. That's they're good. Happy to have that Both new modular facility nice. Out there.
Very nice.
So.
That's good.
Okay. So do I hear a motion to accept this?
So I would like to ask one question.
Okay.
Yes, Family Justice Center, how much did we spend over there initially?
I think it was around $1.3 million, but that's strictly a guess. I'm just, we can get those numbers to you, but it seems like it was 1.3, but I could be off on that.
Windows weren't replaced?
No, there were some window seals that broke, and there are numerous windows. Those building, I'm not sure how many windows encompass that whole building, but there's quite a few of them had the seals broke in them, and so they need to be replaced.
The glass.
Yeah, the glass glasses. Need to be replaced in those. And then they've got some issue with the sun coming in from the east, and it's causing some problems. They're looking at putting blinds in or tinting the windows.
Well, they'll love that during the winter.
Yeah. So anyway.
Can't see the computer, so it doesn't work, right?
That's right, yeah.
Okay. Motion,
I'll make a motion that we move forward with that.
Have a motion?
Second.
A second. All in favor?
Aye.
No opposed? Okay. Thank you. I think you're up again, aren't you?
Yes, Madam Chair. The second item we have is the issue, as a follow-up to your meeting on August the 1st, was the discussion of relocating the commissioner's meeting to the historic courthouse. At the meeting on August the 1st, the issue, or the question was raised about the possibility of relocating these meetings to the overflow room and if we would get some prices related to that. We did get some prices, and these seem high to me also. I've got Frank Merricks here, who's the technical guru to answer any technical questions, but I'll take a stab at it first. What we tried to do was take basically, and this room works great for rebroadcasting the meetings with the sound system and the cameras. It works very good. The final product turns out very well. What we tried to do was replicate that if this meeting was moved over to the other room. One of the things that the company that put this system in gave us a price on trying to replicate that if we moved it over to the other room. Part of the problem is, one of the issues is, the board previously approved for us while we were doing the construction work at the historic courthouse is go ahead and put some of the infrastructure in so that if the board did decide at a future date to move over there, we'd have some of the infrastructure and it would be easier to pull wire and those kind of things. That work hasn't been done over here, so that's an issue on the cost. One of the issues is that if you can either put in a micless I mean, a wireless microphone system, or you can bore into the concrete floor over there that has rebar in it. So what we did is they gave us first a price, and they recommended using a wireless microphone system, which was the $31,266.14. We went back and said, okay, if you got a bore in the floor, bore holes in the floor to run conduit and wiring and all that stuff, what are we looking at there? The cost for that was $30,334.14. That's not including the boring work, and we don't have a price on that, but more than likely that would push the price over doing it with a wireless microphone system. Then we said, okay, let's see what it would cost if we were to basically run all the wiring over there, but have it probably the final product would be us having to run wires across the floor and to set up all the microphones, which is doable, and that was going to be $27,034.14 for that. So those are some options for relocating over there. And then the prices are included down below for the cost of relocating to the historic courthouse. And you do have some drawings on there. I thank Ron King for doing that. He did the current setup is using it for a court system. If you use the overflow room for the commissioner's meeting, you do have a layout there as a proposed layout. It would be a tight layout, but that's not to say reason not to do it, but it would be somewhat tight in trying to get the board up there and the staff that would normally would participate in the meetings. So that's my version of it. If you'd like to ask some questions of Frank, and he can correct anything I misstated on the any of the technical side of it.
Any questions?
How much did it cost to do this room when you did it?
I think it was about
$68,000.
Okay. Yeah. And Scott was heavily involved in that process also, both he and Frank. So.
That was the purchase of the cameras, too, wasn't it?
That was cameras, projector system, sound,
the whole thing. If you subtracted out the purchase of the cameras, what was the cost? And the equipment you got in the middle of it.
Honestly, I'm not sure I could give you an exact number. I'd have to go back and look at the price.
I'd like to know that. Okay. Does the courtroom over there, first of all, I got to say this, tongue-in-cheek, but yes, but I'm serious too. One of the most ridiculous statements I've heard in this whole debate was when you said, as if it was going to be a problem if we move next door, that room was configured like a courtroom. And I thought, well, my God, what is that one up there?
I think the comment I made is that.
I know that's what you said. let me ask, I remember that. And it wasn't out of context.
No, I think what I was talking about is that the nature of that being a courtroom is that from a video and standpoint is that it was not going to give you as good a look as what you get in here. At the historic courthouse, the courthouse has been designed up there with the furniture in such a way that it would give you a better look for a board meeting than this one would, because we can't, there's not much you can do with that courtroom from a camera standpoint as far as having a good presentation for video. That's the issue regarding it being set up for a courtroom. But
what sound equipment is over in that room now for the judges, for the public to hear testimony, and the jury to hear testimony, and so forth?
I don't know that there is there a sound.
There is very little equipment. Most of it's outdated. Things would have to be replaced. I believe Ron King, when he looked at that, said that the speakers were probably from the 1970s. That we're looking at a very old system. I believe there's a couple of pieces of equipment that we put in when we had to put in the projector system, but most of it is very old and is not really ready for this kind of thing.
Well, one of the issues in here is the sound is not amplified in here. Most people think that it, you know, speaking the microphone, that it's actually amplified in here. It's not. This is strictly for recording, for reproduction. And there, because of the size of the room, they did propose to putting speakers in the back of the different areas in the courtroom so that the microphones in there would be amplified so that people in the back of the room could hear what was going on at the board meeting. So
how did you get the wiring over there for the speakers that are in that room right now?
We paid for it. I believe, yeah, we...
Well, you talking about that running?
Yeah, I mean, they pay for it. But I'm saying, how did... I'm assuming these are the two mics that carry the sound from here?
Actually, the sound is run from the sound system in there. In a lot, it's the same thing you get on the television program or the internet. It's a single line that runs up into the ceiling and into their pre-existing sound system. Part of the problem you're going to have, though, is if you move into that room and you rearrange the tables the way Ron has drawn out, is you're going to start facing issues like feedback.
Right.
You're going to face things you're not having to face right now, which means that you're going to have to put in some more expensive equipment to be able to manage that sound structure.
Which is all included in the price.
Which is included in the price quote.
And one other question on that. I remember in the past that there have been some commissioner meetings over there.
Yes.
Several years ago,
budget
I think
hearing.
It was. Yeah. Mm-hmm. How did y'all manage those things at that point in time?
We just laid cables across the floor.
I don't think the budget hearing was televised either.
Okay. See, that was a very temporary sort of situation because it's just kind of like a one-off kind of meeting. So we just temporarily moved some equipment over there and run the cables just kind of and tried to put stuff down where people wouldn't trip over them. Not intending for it to be a permanent situation. Right. The space over there is good for the public because you've got more space for the public.
Right.
But the front of it's made for the judge and the bench and then up there and the prosecutor and defense. When you try to put all the commissioners up there and Craig and Amy and equipment like this, you quickly run out of space because everything in there is bolted down.
What are the three occupancy capacities here and
there? This is 50, I think that's either 125 or 135, and that's 249, I think. At least there's 249 seats if you take up there at the historic courthouse with a balcony.
We already have 49 people there. A
couple budget here.
Maybe. Yeah, budgets you do. Yeah, that's one the only time. Time.
Yeah. And we have nobody in there tonight, is that correct?
No,
that is correct.
Nobody last week, last meeting, you only had department heads in there.
That's correct.
So you probably had at least two meetings in a row where you've been practically single digit with members of the general public. Attending our meetings, so.
And I'm sure there's been some prior to that, Ken.
Well, there were.
Prior to that.
Yeah, there have been.
There have been some prior to that when we only had county officials in there.
Yeah, not employees.
Okay. What's the pleasure?
Well, can I ask Dave?
Sure.
So we're not allowed to have anybody stand around for 15 minutes when we have an overage, is that correct?
That is correct.
You would like be upset.
The posting capacity is 50, yes, sir.
And that's what we pay him to
do. That's what we pay him to do, get upset if he.
That's right.
Well, I don't think at this point, based on the input I've received, that it's worth trying to move right now. I think we ought to do away with the topic, and if we want to resurface it later, we can. That's just
put it. I agree. I think that's what we need to do. I don't think there's any.
Do it at another time if it's
not compelling. To move. Not compelling.
Yeah.
It's a lot more important things we need.
We got
to
a lot. Of, that's right. We got a lot better things to do with our money.
Yeah.
Well, and we have it set up where if the board, the meeting's got that many people here, and within 30 to 45 days, the board could, if they made that decision, we could. Because we have, again, put the infrastructure up there where, adding the relocating cameras would not be.
So we're going to table this matter.
That's exactly what we're doing.
I do have one question, Tim. If we know, like a budget hearing or for whatever reason, if we know we're going to have a big crowd, what would we do today to accommodate the folks that do want to come and listen to what goes on at these meetings? Is there a place we could have a planned alternative?
You could use the courthouse because the microphone system would be working. So that would be amplified throughout the whole courtroom. So that's already been put in for the board meetings, the microphone part of it. You could bring a temporary camera, which we have done school over here. I think we record up here with a temporary camera. So you could bring a temporary camera and video with the temporary camera.
All right, would that temporary camera pick up the mic that Eddie mentioned, the school board? The school
you
board.
You can tie it into the microphone.
We can tie it into our
microphone. Okay, well, then we ought to have that as a fallback position. Right. Four meetings that we know are going to be heavily populated.
Yeah, and most of the furniture is part of what's up there, so setting it up for a board meeting would not be a difficult process.
So if we had a flood in here, we could meet there next time.
We have a flood in here, we got a real big problem.
That's true.
Not to be disrespectful, but if we have a flood on the second floor, we've got some big problems. Could have some pipes burst. We could. So anyway, but yes, we do have that.
I'm good with that.
Okay. We have a consensus here.
Can I keep my seat down?
Yes, sir.
You don't have to move, Tim.
You don't have to move.
Now you got wheels on your chair, Mr. Sutton.
We have a consensus to not do
that.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, then we move on to County Manager's Report.
Alman's Guilford County Line. Thank you, Madam Chair. Just to make you aware, on July 28th, I met with our County Attorney, Guilford County Manager, and also their attorney to discuss the County Line issue. And we've kind of put Guilford County to the side so we could finish dealing with the Orange County Line. And we're at a point now where we feel like we can move forward and begin working on the Guilford County line. You know, if you remember, we did meet jointly with Guilford County in May 2010 at the Gibsonville Town Hall to discuss options that they want us to look at. The meeting didn't go well because we didn't know exactly what direction we wanted and what we really wanted to get out of the meeting. So it just kind of dropped at that point. But during our discussion, basically what the county manager stated was that their option is for the geodetic line. That is their recommendation to us. However, if they would like for us to recommend to them that they look at the 150-foot buffer, very similar to what we did to Orange County, that would have to be a request to this board. They would be willing to look at it. Not to say that they would be willing to adopt it, but they would be willing to consider it. And before we made that option and that as a recommendation, we wanted to come to the board and see your wishes on what you would like us to go back to the Guilford County Board with.
Well, have you heard of how many people they have that have complained about which side they're on? At this point?
I don't think we've got a number. We've not done those public information meetings. But there's a... Historically, there's been a lot. You know, the issue is, you know, still very similar to what we had with Orange County about historically taxed.
Yeah. Well, I think that if we've got a lot of interest there, we need to give them an option. That same option.
I'd like to see us proceed as we did with Orange on that.
That's the key, and I remember talking with Representative Engel about this and what his desire was whenever he has to do what he has to do in the state was to have some degree of consistency. So I would hope we would at least entertain the idea of whatever approach Bruce took in formulating Alamance Orange we do for Alamance Guilford. And I don't know if the buffer you're talking about would do that.
It would be very similar. Yeah. If the board is agreeable, we would give them a copy of the local bills that we did with Orange County, talk about the process that we worked with them. But again, they're geodetic straight line people until we ask different.
I say we ask. I don't know if it's proper to do a motion now to do it, but
probably would need to be a motion.
Okay.
We'll make a motion.
Okay, go ahead.
Wait, okay.
The meeting that we had in Gibsonville, what date was that?
That was May 2000. I have the date.
May of 2010?
Yes, sir.
10, yeah.
Okay. I assume we were given a copy of the resolution they did. Did they bring up that resolution at that meeting?
Well, that kind of precated us having the meeting because they basically, on their own, without the county's input, they passed this resolution for the straight line, and they were ready to submit a local bill based on the straight line.
They said on local bill down there.
You mean without our
Without our input.
Right.
If I'm missing something,
I think Skip sent a local bill in, because I asked him, I said, why'd you send that down there?
Yeah. They went and did that without our input, and that's why we asked for that meeting to try to see, to have some dialogue. Again, from that Gibsonville meeting in May to the time that Clyde and I met in July with the county manager, it's been the only discussion that we've had on the line. But, you know, again, we basically said, let us finish Orange first. You know, you don't want to fight two wars on two different fronts. So we wanted to get the Orange County done first, and we feel like we're in a good direction now that we could start on the other side.
Well, I've seen the Guilford County Tax Administrator twice, inadvertently, at lunch at Greensboro. And both times, he has said that he hopes they don't move the line like we did. And I even drew him a map on a napkin this other last week. And I said, you know, we came down a street. It's obvious the street was county line. Fire a shotgun up the street and I hit a house. That's just my belief. And Mebane officials couldn't really tell you how they laid the street out there. I found that to be amazing. But I showed him how we came out and came down behind houses and then went back in so business could stay in Orange County. And he just shook his head. He said, you're opening up all kind of problems. So. Yeah, I like to see us get over with. I'd be shocked if they moved the line from geodetic. But
okay. I'll entertain a motion at this time.
I'll make that motion that we move forward to do as we did in the Orange County.
Second that.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay. Okay, that took care of that one. And Mr. Honeycutt?
Next, in front of you is a proposed policy for the use of our court system. With all the renovations that we've done to the historic courthouse and also to civil courts, we don't have a policy with respect to use. And one of the concerns that has kind of come up, we were concerned that as much money as we put into it, we want to make sure that we protected our asset as much as possible. I'll give you a prime example. Had a guy who wanted to shoot a music video at the courthouse and wanted the county's approval on it. And I said, no. And he said, show me a policy. And I said, well, no. We're just not going to allow you to shoot a music video. I said, you can come and ask the board. I said, but I can't approve that. But this would put some guidelines with respect to making sure that we don't become a permanent meeting location, that we, you know, make sure that we don't have people bringing food inside. One of the big issues is that we're not going to have our bathrooms open downstairs any longer when Graham has downtown events. That's been the practice in the past, is that the bathrooms have been open. But, you know, as much money as we put into them, we're a little concerned about vandalism. But this would also make sure that we had security on site and also that there is a charge for the use of the facility.
Had we charged in the past?
No, sir.
Okay. Yeah, this is good. This is a good.
Where did you get your fee schedule?
We kind of made it up ourselves. What we kind of looked at is what would it cost an employee to come in and try to add a little bit more for utilities.
Does this cover custodial expenses, or is that the responsibility of whoever?
We'll cover custodial as well.
So we would
right, be responsible. Right. But we'd make sure that we had on-site staff at these type of events. You know, that in the past we have given keys out to open and close. We're changing the security on it, you know, to allow the swipe card systems, and, you know, it just can get very confusing.
Well, and this looks fine. You may want to use, if not use, you may want to examine, if you haven't already, what the school system does. I know when Ronnie Wall was head of facilities, this was a big deal, and we came up with a fairly comprehensive policy. It may have a whole lot more than you want, but if you haven't looked at something else, you may want to just make sure there's nothing missing.
We did, I believe, we got this from another county. Tori put it on the listserv and asked what other counties did, and I think this was Watauga. So we kind of based it off of that template.
Okay. Do I hear a motion that we accept this policy for reserving and usage of the Alamance County Civil Courts building? I have a motion.
Second.
And second. All in favor say aye.
Aye. Madam Chair, I do want to mention just a couple other things, if I could. One of the things that I've sent you information on in the past is about setting up a meeting between the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners, their staff, and our legislative delegation. We do have that meeting set up for September 28th. It will be in the morning. We will have lunch that will be provided. Part of their legislative outreach is they want counties to have direct contacts with their legislative delegation, and they're willing to facilitate this meeting. We do have Senator Gunn and Representative Borson and Engel agreeing to be here that morning. So that is September 28th, if you would make sure to mark your calendars for that.
And that's with the
legislative outreach, yes, ma'am. Alyssa Willett.
What time is that?
We're looking probably 8 to 12:30-ish. The time frame we don't have specific yet. We don't have that agenda.
Okay.
We'll be that morning. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Any questions about that? And one other thing, please remember our ribbon cutting for the historic courthouse is Saturday. It starts at 10, but if possible, if you could be there by 9:30, and please find Tori, and Tori will show you where you're seated. So we have a lot of people that have RSVP'd. I think it really will be a very, very nice event. But if you could be there by 9:30, it would be great.
Okay. Moving on to the consent agenda. Does anybody want to pull anything from the consent agenda?
I had a minor correction in a meeting from last minute.
Okay.
Chair Massey was not with us.
I was not. It says I'm absent.
I know, but on the next page it says you presented the consent agenda. So just a minor error. I'm sure it can be corrected. Bill wanted credit for that, didn't you, Bill?
Yeah.
And you get an extra 5 cent pay.
All right. Take care of that. So now do I...
I'll make that motion.
We have a motion to approve. Have
yes.
A motion to approve with the correction.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
No opposed. At this time, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 to consult with the county attorney in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the Board of Commissioners regarding the case of United States versus Alamance County et al. And the case of Alamance County versus Crown Castle. I need a motion.
So moved.
Have a motion by Bill Lashley and a second. At this time, we will go into closed session.